but we're talking about heaven and our going to heaven. We started three weeks ago, with the fact that the early church knew something about heaven that we do not know. Because when it came to death and martyrdom and what have you, they were very excited. They were glad to go. And in our culture, in this Western culture that we live in this the 2015, none of us want to go. We all want to hang on to this life right now. And many people, when it's time for them to go, they go scratching and clawing and pleading, God heal me, God, I'm not ready to go right now. So what was it the early church knew that we did not know? And that's what we've been discovering for the last 3 weeks, and we're going to wrap up today. They knew something, and they were excited about it. They were excited about heaven. They were excited about seeing God. They were excited about a face-to-face encounter. So we're going to start today by looking at Psalms chapter 63 and verse 1. O God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My body longs for you in a dry and weary land where there is no water. So what the psalmist is saying in this psalm is that he recognizes the fact that his soul is thirsting for God. And he recognizes the fact that his body is also thirsting for God. And he recognizes that his soul and his body is thirsting for God, this encounter with God, while he is here on earth in a very dry and weary land where there is no water, where there is really no, there is not the ability to satisfy. Now listen carefully. You can try all kinds of things in life that you think might satisfy you. But David is saying that it is impossible for you to be satisfied in this dry and barren land where there is no water. You cannot be satisfied outside of God's presence. And I'm going to explain why in just a second. You see, because God's presence is what brings complete satisfaction. And the absence of his presence creates a thirsting and a longing. So our longing to go to heaven and our desire to go to heaven is rooted in a desire to be in God's presence. You see, God's greatest gift in heaven, as it was in the Garden of Eden, God's greatest gift was that of himself. All right, let me explain it this way. It is his presence that completes you and I. When we were created with a divine need for his presence. And aside from his presence, you and I are incomplete. There is a part of us that is missing. There is something down within us that we know inherently it is missing. That's why David is praying this prayer. He says, my body is crying out for you. My soul is crying out for you. I know that there is something missing, and I need you to fulfill it. I need you to make that up in my life. See, we were created with a need for his presence to complete us. Without it, we are not complete. That's why there's such a desire for drugs and what have you. People are trying to complete themselves, but they don't realize that it takes his presence, his very presence, to complete us. That's why worship is so important. You see, we spoke about this weeks ago when we talked about worship. You see, worship is not for God. Now, I know that crosses a theological line someplace, but it is not God needing worship. God doesn't need to be praised. God doesn't need to be told how great he is. God doesn't need any of that. God already knows it. He is God.
All right.
And if you think you do a good job in it, let me tell you, there are angels and they're created beings whose job it is to worship 24/7. Let's see you do that. So God does not need our worship. I'm sorry if that blows your theology. God God doesn't need our worship. He is not so hungry for attention that he goes, "Oh, I just wish City Church would worship me today so it makes me feel good in heaven." God needs worship so that he can come down and he can fulfill you and turn you into the person that he created you to be. Because only his presence as he engages with you will do that. That's why worship is so important. Worship is all about me. It's all about God's presence fulfilling me and making me all that I am and I'm supposed to be. You see, there are believers today that don't even know who the real them is. Because they've never entered that place of worship where they've been fulfilled and that missing part has been completed in them. And they realize, this is who I really am. That comes only in a place of worship. That comes only in a place of being in God's presence. Because only his presence can do it. Until you find that place and you go to that place, you live life uncompleted. In fact, let me just go a step further. Salvation does not complete you. Now, before you think I'm a heretic, let me explain. Salvation does not complete you. Salvation is the gateway that allows you into God's holy of holy, into his presence through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
That's what salvation is. Salvation forgives you of your sins so that God, when he looks at you, he sees Jesus Christ and not who you had become in a decayed, fallen world. He sees his son, and because he sees his son, he can come close to you in his presence because he has blotted out all of your sin. Salvation is a gateway into God's presence. But you see, some believers think, well, I just get saved. And if I just get saved, well, then that's all there is to it. I'm now completed. No, salvation is the open door. But you've got to get close to God. You've got to worship the Lord. You've got to spend time in his presence. And when you do, I promise you this, you'll sit back and you'll feel a feeling of divine completeness.
That's right.
The answer to drug addiction isn't tie yourself up and lock yourself up and just don't do it. That is not the answer, because deep inside, what drives addiction is a feeling of being incomplete and needing something to complete you. But if you'll replace that addiction with the presence of God, and you'll begin to spend time in his presence, and when we gather together, be one of the first persons to throw your hands in the air and worship Almighty God, you'll find that God moves in you in such a way that the thirst for the addiction will go away because you have now been completed because of his presence. Revelation chapter 22 and verse 4 said, they will see his face. They will see his face. Close your eyes for a minute. Just close your eyes. Bear with me. Close your eyes and think for a minute what it will be like when God Almighty walks up to you and he says, "Hello. Hello, Scott. I made you. I created you. I'm the one that formed you and breathed the breath of life." How awesome and powerful. You see, when we see his face, that is the ultimate of completion. Because there is nothing more of his presence than you can get than that. That's why heaven is the ultimate of completing who we are. You can open your eyes, they'll go to sleep on me. Some of you went off in a dreamland someplace. I don't know. You were entering his presence. Yes. You forgot all about truth.
Yes.
All
right.
You see, in the Old Testament, the priests were allowed to go into the holiest of holies once a year, but they were never allowed to see God. In fact, Moses came about the closest any human being came to seeing God when God put him on the cliff, and he said, "You know what?" He said, "I'm going to walk by you and let you see my back parts." Now, I'm of the belief that Moses actually did not see God's back parts. that Moses saw where God had been and gone. And he saw the trail of God. That's as close as man has ever come to being in God's presence. But Revelations is telling us that when we go home to heaven, we will see his face. That means that we will be looking eye to eye with God, and we will behold him in all of his greatness. 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 16 says that he lives in unapproachable light whom no one has seen or can see. Because of our fallen state, our body cannot handle seeing God for who he is. That's why we don't physically see him. But because of the presence of the Holy Spirit, God has put himself in us through the Holy Spirit. We can feel his awesome presence through the Holy Spirit and the ministry of the Spirit. We don't see him, but we can feel him. Some of you are feeling his presence right now, though you do not see his manifestation and his glory. But we're feeling his presence. Some of us, because we've been worshiping, you're sitting here today and you're feeling a sense of completeness. You're feeling like it's all okay. Everything just seems to be okay right now because his presence is completing you. You see, the goal is when we leave here to continue to seek out his presence every day and experience that completion every day. That's the goal. Are you with me? Okay, number two, we're going to take it a step further because I'm trying to wrap this up. Number two is I believe we need to learn to enjoy God. You see, I come from an old school background where we went to church and we got beat up. We got told everything we were doing wrong and how we were going to hell, and we got beat up. Every Sunday was a slap around Sunday. We went home repenting, and we didn't know what it was to enjoy God. But I've been doing a little project and a little research about creation, and I've come to believe that God has created everything that you and I see for, first of all, for his enjoyment, and then he's created it for our enjoyment with him. Now bear with me because I'm going to break it down. Everything, even though the curse has diminished and destroyed it, it is still God's creation and it is still there for us to enjoy. It is a sample of what we will see in heaven. And when we see it in heaven, we will see it as being God's creation untouched by the curse. You see, you think a flower is beautiful now, wait till you go to heaven. You think animals are beautiful now, wait till you go to heaven. When the Bible says that children will put their hands in the viper's den and they will not be bitten, and the lion will lay down with other animals and they will not destroy each other. That is a picture of heaven. The same thing we see now, we will see in heaven, but untouched by the curse. But even that we see now, God has created it nonetheless, and it is there for our enjoyment. In fact, I believe that God wants us to enjoy his creation because he enjoys it. He enjoys it. So let's ask this question. I want you to see God in a different light, so bear with me. Let's ask this question. Why did God create the universe if he is a free and all-sufficient being? Why did God make the universe, and it goes beyond even our imagination and our ability to see, even with the telescopes that we have today? Why did God create it? And I believe he's still creating, by the way. That's just a side note. Why did God create all of that? When he is all self-sufficient, and he doesn't need to. Did God need the universe to fulfill himself? Did God need you and I to fulfill himself? No, he's God. He's all sufficient. He doesn't need anything. He's good with it. He's good without it. He's all sufficient. So why did God create
and make all that we see. And we have the story of creation in the book of Genesis. Why did he do that? Well, I found a German theologian that gives an answer. His name is Jürgen Moltmann. And he says, it's actually in his book, The Theology of Play. He said that God created all that we see is actually in the book of Proverbs, chapter 8. God created all that we see because God was actually at play. God was playing. Now some of us go, well, what do you mean that God was playing? What, how, explain that. Let's look at Proverbs chapter 8, and we're gonna begin at verse 22. Now this is a very interesting portion of Scripture because in this portion of Scripture, wisdom is speaking. Now again, I'm gonna go out on a limb because some people are gonna think I'm nuts, but I think wisdom isn't something necessarily in our head, but I believe that as we read the book of Proverbs, wisdom is referred to as a person or a part of God, and it's referred to in the female form.
Right.
Seek her, and she will be found of you. Call upon her, and she will speak to you. I believe that there is this, I don't even know how to put it in a word, but there is this part of God, a separate part called wisdom, and the writer here is referring to wisdom as a herb. So in verse 22, this is wisdom speaking. And the Lord brought me forth as the first fruits of his work. Wisdom is saying, I was created before anything. Before his deeds of old, and I was appointed from eternity, from the beginning, before the world began. When there was no ocean, I was given birth. And when there were no springs abounding with water, before the mountains were settled in place, before the hills, I was given birth. Before he made the earth or its fields or any of the dust of the world, I was there when he set the heavens in place. And he marked out the horizon on the face of the deep, when he established the clouds above and fixed securely the fountains of the deep. When he gave the sea its bounty so the waters would not overstep his command. And when he marked out the foundations of the earth, then I was the craftsman at his side. I was filled with delight day after day, rejoicing always in his presence, rejoicing in his whole world and delighting in mankind. This is wisdom speaking. Wisdom was there when God was at play, rejoicing in all that God was doing. Wisdom was there when God was creating and rejoicing. What is that word to rejoice? Have you ever been so happy you just started shouting and jumping around and getting so excited about something that you became giddy? You became a little rum-dum? No, you didn't have anything to drink. It wasn't a party. But you became a little... That's what that word... That's rejoice. I rejoiced. I got so excited in what he was doing. I couldn't stand it. Look at what God... God is at play. Look at what he is creating. And see, because when God creates and he demonstrates the ability to create, God literally, his creation, that which he makes, displays his glory. That's why he creates. It shows his glory. And then he steps back and he says, I like what I made. Didn't that happen in Genesis? After everything that he made, he stepped back and said, it is good. I think I'll make something else. And he made a something else, and he stepped back, and he said, well, that's pretty good too. And wisdom's going, yeah, that's pretty great. Let's do it again. Do something else. God created a something else. And he stepped back, and he goes, that's pretty good too. I like that. And wisdom's going, tremendous, tremendous. And then God said, hey, I got an idea. Check it out. Why don't we make man in our image? Wisdom's going, cool, let's try it, do it. So you think I'm crazy, but this is how my mind thinks. So he said, all right, let me see what I can do. Everybody stand back. Come on, everybody get back. We're going to make a man in our image. It's never been done before, but I'm God. I'm pretty good at making stuff. So he formed Adam. And he said, what do you guys think? Wisdom, what do you think of Adam? And wisdom's going, pretty exciting, but he's not moving, God. Do something. He's not moving. God said, watch this. I'm going to make him in our image. I'm going to breathe the breath of life like we live. I'm breathing the breath of life into him. And man became alive. And he looked back, God is saying this. He looked back, he goes, man, and it is pretty good. I think I did a good job. God is creating, he's at play, and he has made everything that we see and touch and feel, and all of the things that we think we're so smart and we can do through technology. Oh, God is light years. He created the fiber optics before we knew what they were. All right? We send a spaceship up to the moon or to Mars, God is just laughing. He's going, man, these guys think they're so cool. They send that little piece of metal up here. Look, I've got galaxies out there that I've created. They don't even know exist because they're there for my pleasure. See, we look at the earth today and we don't see the deepest parts of the oceans. We don't even see the middle of the Atlantic. You go down on the beach and you're going to see a mile or two out. That's the extent of it. And you certainly don't, by standing on the beach, see all that God has created. You don't look at the mountaintops across the world and in the rainforest. You don't look at cloud formations. And, you know, the Bible said that God is so thrilled with his creation and he knows it so intimately that even if a bird falls out of the air, he knows it. You see, God is watching all of that. He's thrilled with his creation. And then he invites us to participate in what he has made. Next time you're driving down the highway, look at what God has made and tell him, and it is good. We were driving in on the 680 and Deborah said, look at all these mountains and these fields. I looked and I said, man, God, it is good. It is good. When you see a bird land on your porch, tell God, it is good. You did a good job. You see, God takes pleasure in his creation. But let me tell you, oh, you're going to really think I'm crazy. God has a sense of humor. Even in his creation. Why did God create an ostrich? And a giraffe. Have you ever seen a platypus? One of those platypus with a beaky thing out there? You know why God, this is my own thing. You know why God created those? To mess with you and me. Because we can't figure it out. It's funny. I look at some of God's creations. I think, God, you truly had a sense of humor. Because you created some pretty funny stuff. I'm sorry. Look at them. Go out of National Geographic or the Nature Channel. Look at some of God's great. They're hysterical. I think God has a sense of humor. He made some of that just to laugh and go, look at that. Isn't that funny? That's so cute. I love it. Have you ever looked at a rhinoceros? Oh, I'm nuts. I get it. Look at each other. Not that you're a rhinoceros. Look at each other. Do you see where your eyes are at in your head? Right? Right? Okay, so if you look at a bird, their eyes are pretty much at the same place, right? Okay. You look at your doggy, the eyes are in the same place. You look at an elephant, the eyes are in the same place, right? Go home, look at your kitty cat, the eyes are, they're kind of centered. Have you ever... A rhinoceros has this long head. I looked the other day, I said, God, you put his eyes down at the bottom. They're not even centered. Truly, you think that's funny. Go home and look. I'm telling you the truth. Their eyes, never mind. But I think God, in his creation, he messes with us. We got to lighten up a little bit about God. We think that God is just this guy up there waiting for us to do something wrong so he can just let us know we did something wrong. I think God wants to have fun with us. Do you know that when God walked in the garden with Adam, what do you think they talked about? You think they talked about theology? I think he and Adam laughed and cut up and had a good time and enjoyed one another's company. Sometimes when we pray, we make it all so serious. Oh, most heavenly Father, hallowed be thy name. Do ABC for me. Amen. Sometimes God wants to just have some fellowship and laugh at you and laugh with you. I shouldn't tell you this, but God laughed at me one day in church. I think I did tell you before. Right in that stairwell. I was having a panic attack because back in the day we used to turn on lights up there, service starting. Somebody didn't turn on the lights and I was frustrated. And I ran up the stairs mumbling and grumbling to God. God, why do I have to turn on the lights? Why do I have to? Then why aren't they even here doing what they're supposed to do, God? And I literally felt God laughing at me and going, aren't you cute? You just stress over everything, don't you? You are just the cutest thing. I love you to death. Seriously. I came down the stairs laughing and smiling. You know, it did something to me. I'm not joking with you. So we have a phrase. We say, well, we really shouldn't put our attention. It's not the gift, it's the giver. It's not the gift, it's the giver. Well, if you are sick, and you have the flu, and I come visit you, and I bring you a bowl of soup, what is it that you enjoy? Is it the soup that makes you feel better, or is it the fact that I came over to your house? It's actually both. You see, I was the vehicle that brought you the soup. You can't have the soup without the vehicle. So we need to be careful. It's not, don't get thrilled with the gift. It's all about the giver. No, it's actually both. God gives you stuff and God blesses you so that you can and will enjoy it. Amen. It's the gift, but it's also the giver. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 17 through verse 19, we're going to read. Command those who are rich in this present world, not to be arrogant, not to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Let's stop there. Who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. God will bless you for your enjoyment. You see, God blesses you for you to enjoy, and God also blesses you so that you can give up and lay treasures in heaven. Do you think God frowns when you read a good book, or you see a good movie, or you eat a good meal, or you're in good fellowship with somebody? Do you think God is saying that, no, I don't like that. You shouldn't have any pleasures in life. No, I believe that God creates these things for us to enjoy. Romans 8, verse 32. He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also along with him graciously give us all things? Psalms chapter 36 and verse 8. They feast on the abundance of the house you give them. Drink from your river of delights. I'll throw another one at you since I'm on a run. Do you know that God will serve you and I in heaven? Luke chapter 12, verse 37. It will be good for those servants who the master finds them watching when he comes. But I tell you the truth. This is speaking of God. I tell you the truth. He will dress himself to serve and he will have them recline at the table, and he will come and wait on them. Could it be that God is so desirous for our comfort and our joy and our feeling fulfilled that he in heaven will actually dress like a servant and wait on you and I? He will break all cultural norms. The God Almighty who created you and I and created heaven actually becomes a servant in heaven to wait on us while we recline. Just get your mind around that for a minute. We're going to move to number three. Are you ready? A couple of years ago, Deborah and I stayed at a hotel in Redondo Beach where I grew up. And down in the lobby, they had a saltwater fish tank. And it was probably one of the most elaborate fish tanks I've ever seen. Had all these exotic fishes, and they were swimming back and forth and doing their thing. And the thought came to me while I was looking at the fish tank. The thought came to me is, do they really know that they're in a fish tank? I mean, somewhere in their DNA, did they feel like, I don't really belong here. There's something greater out there. I was really created for open water. Is there something in their DNA that they sense that when they swim across the tank and come to the glass, and then they swim back to the other side of the tank and come to the other glass, and they go back and forth all day long. Is there something in them that cries out, I don't belong here? Well, the question is there something in us that deep down we don't necessarily recognize it, but it's there that is crying out to God, I don't belong here, God. I do not belong here. I really belong in your presence. I belong back in the Garden of Eden. That's where I was created for. That's where truly I belong. There's something in me that's crying out. Do you know that the Bible says that even creation is crying out to God right now? When you walk out and you see the trees and the bushes and the lawn, that the Bible says creation is crying out, God, come quickly. Bring us back to what you created us to be. Come quickly. I watched a movie with Deborah last night. They were singing the song, Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, coming for to carry me home. Do we sing those songs because deep down we know this really isn't where we belong, that there really is another home? We're like the fish in the fish tank. We're here, but we don't feel right about it. Something's really missing. Theologian Donald Walsh says this: our greatest afflictions is not anxiety or even guilt, but rather a homesickness, a tremendous yearning to be home with God. Could it be that a lot of what we go through emotionally and the depressions that we face and all of that is because deep down there is a longing to be with God and we don't recognize it? And we just think it's these other things, but deep down there is a homesickness within us. You see, home is where you should be able to go and feel relaxed. Home is where you should be able to go and be yourself. Home is where you should be able to go and take your makeup off and be you. And I think that while we're here on earth, we never truly feel that. I go home and set alarms. I don't go to bed unless the alarm's set. How relaxed is that? I don't think we're capable of feeling that because we're in a fish tank and we're not in our true element. Until we get home. Jesus said this, blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. There are a lot of books written about being optimistic. I believe that heaven should be the believer's optimism. A lot of books written about being optimistic. I've got a stack of books on positive thinking and management and all of that. I spent years ago, I devoured everything I could find. I could probably do seminars on it, I don't know. But let me tell you something. Those books and those seminars are done by people that, yes, they make a buck. And they may achieve something in this life. They may climb a ladder, but it's the old saying, in corporate climbing and succeeding, you can climb the ladder of success, but what if when you get to the top, you realize it's on the wrong building? So they climb it, and they get to be a something and recognized as an expert in their field, and they go on the road and they do seminars. But you know the one thing that is true among them all? They all grow old, and they all die. Many of them go to hell. Now, how optimistic is that? When the end of your life is a life in hell, how optimistic is that? True optimism is knowing that you're going to heaven and it'll all be okay. Yeah, it may be rough right now and it might be rough going right now, but in the end, it will all be okay. You see, that is optimism built not on sand, but optimism built on a rock. You see, when you build that kind of thinking on a rock, you know, this life is going to end. But it ain't all there is. There is eternity following. And I know what eternity looks like. And because I know what eternity looks like, I am very optimistic. It's all okay. Nothing can set me back now because this is temporary and I know where I'm going. Luke chapter 6. Blessed, in verse 22. Blessed are you when men hate you, when they exclude you, when they insult you, when they reject you. Your name is evil because of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, because great is your reward in heaven. Great is your reward in heaven. Way beyond our ability to even imagine. You know, if I can look forward to that, I can put up with my nasty neighbor one more week. If I can look forward to that relative of mine that gets under my skin, I can just overlook them because it's just a short time compared to what's coming in eternity. I'm going to leave you with my last point. It takes a paradigm shift.
Right.
A paradigm shift. And really, this is really where I was headed today. I want you to change your paradigm with me. It takes a paradigm shift. David said that our life is but a breath. Did you hear that? When I said that, you breathed probably two times. Our life is but a breath. Okay, Tranquil, wave your hand. Okay, Tranquil's in the back. He heads our sermon research department. And this is the research he gave me this last week. Adults and teenagers breathe 12 to 18 breaths per minute. We breathe 960 breaths in an hour, 23,000 breaths in a day. So if you do simple mathematics, we take a breath of air every 3.5 to 5 seconds. When I read that, you breathed once. Every 3.5 to 5 seconds, we take a breath of air. Life is short. You have to ask yourself what's really important. Let's put it in perspective. In light of eternity, if our life is 3.5 seconds, that's how often we take a breath. 3.5 maybe to 5 seconds, you and I are taking a breath. If you're excited, it lessens. If you're very calm, you might reach the 5-second mark. Yeah, but let's think about it. Your life and my life in light of eternity. 1, 2, 3, breathe. That was your life. 1, 2, 3, breathe. That was your life. You're now gone. It's amazing that everything that happens in eternity is what you and I do in the 3.5 seconds. So you have to ask yourself, what's really important? It's all in how I use my 3.5 seconds, which is determines my eternity. That's pretty quick, isn't it? That's what your and my life is like. 3.5 seconds. How you use it determines your eternity. Ecclesiastes chapter 2. Verse 4 through 11. This is now being written by the most powerful, the most wealthy man in the world in his day. I undertook great projects. I built houses for myself and planted vineyards. I made gardens and parks and planted all kinds of fruit trees in them. I made reservoirs to water groves of flourishing trees. I bought male and female slaves and had other slaves who were born in my house. I also owned more herds and flocks than anyone in Jerusalem before me. I amassed silver and gold for myself and the treasure of kings and provinces. I acquired men and women singers and a harem as well as the delights of the heart of man. I became greater by far than anyone in Jerusalem before me. In all of my wisdom stayed with me. I denied myself nothing my eyes desired. I refused my heart no pleasure. My heart took delight in all my work. And this was the reward for all my labor. Yet, when I surveyed all that my hands had done and what I had toiled to achieve, everything was meaningless. In chasing after the wind, nothing was gained under the sun. John told me the other week that the word here, meaningless, is another word used in our day to mean absurd. It was absurd. It was absolutely ridiculous. I chased after all of this. And in the end of my life, it was meaningless. So what do you take in your 3.5 seconds? What do you take to heaven? What do you take into eternity? Do you take your car? Do you take your jewelry? Do you take your job? Do you take your house? How about your bank account? 3.5 seconds to lay up all of that. Does any of it go with you? Not a thing. So what do you take with you? The fact that you love other people, that you take into eternity. The fact that you give to people, that you take into eternity. The fact Jesus gave many parables, the Good Samaritan. The fact that you see somebody on the roadside and you bind up their wounds, you put ointment on them, you take them into the caretaker, you pay for their stay, and then you come back to see if they're okay. That lasts for eternity. The fact that Jesus said, when I was in prison, when I was hungry, when I was naked, you clothed me, when I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. That when you've done it to the least of these, you've done it to me. That you take into eternity. You see, those are all the things that we do for other people. That's what you take into eternity. It's not what you do for you, I'm sorry to say. All the stuff we think we do for us, we leave behind. But it's what you do for other people you take into eternity. Mark chapter 9, verse 41, we're going to close here. And I tell you the truth, anyone who gives you a cup of water in my name because you belong to Christ will certainly not lose his reward. Now, I don't know about you, but I can speak for myself that in looking at heaven and eternity and my 3.5 seconds, I have reevaluated everything in my life. That 3.5 seconds go by so fast, it's just a breath. Is it okay if I don't have some of the things I think I need? Is it okay that I don't have some of the things I think I want? Is that all right? You bet it is. 3.5 seconds in light of eternity. I want to lay up treasure in heaven because how I use this time determines how I spend that time. And I want to use this time wisely because it's that time that counts. Amen? You know, we focus over the smallest, most petty things. We focus over petty things at church. Well, I don't like the way Sister so-and-so, what she did to me. Oh, they didn't put me in charge of the kitchen. I don't know what's wrong with them. We focus on petty things that just don't matter. In light of eternity, it doesn't matter. Give it up. Focus on what's eternal. That's where the payback is. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. I'm going to ask you to pray. And if you're like me, I'm asking God, God, shift my paradigm. Shift my paradigm, Lord. Shift my paradigm. And I'm going to invite you to pray also. God, shift our paradigm. Father, we thank you for heaven. We thank you that that is where we're going. You've created it for us. Father, we focus so much on what happens in our life now to bring us pleasure, to bring us fulfillment, to do for us, Lord, when we should be focusing on laying up treasures in heaven. Father, I pray that you, by your Holy Spirit, will begin to take the scales off our eyes. Help us to see life for what it really is. Help us to see heaven for what it really is. And Lord, by your Holy Spirit, do a paradigm shift within us. That rather than living our life for us, that we will live this short time that we have, this breath that we have, this 3.5 seconds that we have, that we will live it to minister to other people, and in doing so, lay up treasures in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen.